this.
Hey, Jim.
I debated as to whether I should come down here so you could hear me or not, and I get down here and the mic doesn't work.
I know, it's... I blame the sound man.
We have announcements out for the position of director of music, and Brother Mel Alstrander is the chairman of the personnel committee. He couldn't be here today, so he asked me to sort of bring you up to date with what that process is. We've had it on the website, the church website, for some time. We placed an ad in the Anniston Star, the Jacksonville News, and so far we have not really been astounded with applicants. And so Brother Chris here has reached out to CBF and is pursuing that avenue as far as getting some applicants. And we're in good hands. We all know that with Sean, but he's asked to for us to seek outside applicants for this position, and that's why we're doing it. So I just wanted to bring you up to date. It's not an issue that's lying around that we're not working on. Our progress hasn't been as good as we'd like for it to be, but we'll continue to work. Y'all pray for us that the right person will apply for this position. Thank you.
Thank you. That's okay. Can you yell, or do you want to use this thing?
How loud do you need me to be? Can you hear me now? Good.
Okay. Awesome. I'll take my seat.
I just wanted to let everybody know Vacation Bible School is going to be different this year. It's kind of a weekend kids blast. We wanted to do it on a weekend so that everybody in the church who never gets to participate in Vacation Bible School can actually come and have a part in this, because working with the kids, even just for one weekend, is really pretty awesome. So if you've never gotten a chance to do it, please put on your schedule, it's June 26th, 27th, and 28th. The 27th, that Saturday, is going to be the bulk of the time that we spend. We're going to have a kickoff on that Friday night and a celebration on Sunday night. And basically, the morning of the 27th is the morning we're going to ask as many people as can to come and help us out, help move the kids from place to place, just spend time with them, shake their hands, know their names, help them color, help them learn what we have to teach them. So because, you know, this is their church too, and we want everybody to get to know the kids in the church and to work together. And it's a blessing for everybody, not just them, but for all of us who volunteer. So if you're interested at all in helping out with VBS, we'll be having more announcements in the next coming weeks. Once we make sure we know exactly who we need where, we're going to be having a meeting where everybody who wants to volunteer at all can come and meet with us. So if you're interested, talk to me. You can talk to Rhonda, Christy, Chris, Lauren, who am I missing? Who else is on the children's committee? Anyone that you know is on the children's committee. You're not. So, thank you very much, and I look forward to seeing y'all there.
Thank you for coming up here and speaking as loudly as you can. All right, let me try to do this. I think my voice is loud enough. Tonight, we will not have our regular evening worship in here, but we're going to go out to our CMC and play volleyball. So come at 6 o'clock. I'm going to put you on a team with all ages, and we're going to play against each other. It's going to be fun, so come. Make sure you come back Wednesday night, 6:30. We'll have our usual Bible study time for all ages. Know that right after service this morning, if you are planning to go on the mission trip to Texas, there will be a meeting in our choir room right after the service. And you may not know this, but next Sunday morning, our youth and our chaperones will be leaving for Passport. So we're really excited about that. We ask that you pray for us and our trip. But a lot of the kids are still in need of a couple of stocks to be sold. They're $10. So if you have not been asked, you know, there's a little shyness going on. So come see me, and I'll help them ask you for a stock, you know, if you would like to give. All right? So I have done my part. Now it's your part. It's time for you to stand and find someone to hug on this morning, shake hands with, or just say good morning.
Jews are brutes, slaves are free. And we were all made to drink of one spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot were to say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear were to say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them as he chose.
Good morning again. You can hear me, right? I mean, I'm gifted with the invisible lapel. So it is good to see you all here this morning as we've come together for worship. And as we join together, let's begin our time with a word of prayer. Great God, we come to you this morning as this diverse body of Christ, with all of our different strengths and all of our different weaknesses. Lord, we come together for worship. God, may we do just that this morning. May your Holy Spirit be with us, free us, Lord, from whatever it is that may distract us from the call to worship. And Lord, may we feel your presence as you speak to us through Holy Scripture, the singing of songs, and Lord, whatever words, God, you have for us. So be with us now, we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
speaking of voices, let's sing a hymn this morning. Hymn number 18, Come We That Love the Lord. We'll sing first, second, third, and fifth.
Thank you.
I was going to say, maybe I'm not working out. Good morning.
Good morning.
You guys tired? Has summer already wore you out? Already? No. Right? No. No, not right. All right, I want you guys to, can you guys pretend pretty good?
Yeah.
Right, I want you to pretend with me for a minute, okay? I want you to pretend that you're just one big eyeball. Just one, doesn't matter what color it is or anything, one big eyeball, okay? Now, what can you do pretty good if you're just an eyeball?
See.
See? Okay. Anything else you can do if you're an eyeball? Look. See? That's about it, right? Okay, now I want you to imagine you're something else, okay? Just shake it out of your head. I got to do that sometimes, okay? All right, now imagine you're just one big ear. And it's been clean. It's been, you can hear and listen. That's good. What else can you do if you're a big ear? Or just an ear? Maybe have an earring. That's kind of cool, right? But hear, listen. Okay, now I want you to imagine, this one might be kind of, imagine one big nose. What can you do? You can smell. What else you do with your nose?
Find your way around.
Find your way around.
Yeah. Bats can't hear if they smell. They listen.
Oh, that's good. Bats, they can't. They listen, right? So you can smell. Can you? You can breathe with your nose. Mm-hmm. Can you see with your nose?
No.
Can you hear with your nose?
No.
No. There's some other stuff we can do with our nose, but we won't talk about it. And so can you hear with your eyes?
No.
No. Can you smell with your eyes?
No. No.
So you need all that stuff, right, to do all those things. Like even if you're just going to, I don't know, if you're eating breakfast this morning, you had to use your hands and your mouth and your eyes. Well, you know, God said that He made our bodies that way, and He made the church that way. Like some people are really good at being, I don't know, like eyeballs. They can see stuff really good. They can do stuff really good that other people can't do. And then those people can do things really good that other people can't do. And a guy named Paul wrote about that in the Bible and talked about that's what God wants. That's why the church is a bunch of people and not just one. That's why our body has all, we have fingers and toes, eyes and ears, a nose and a mouth. Some people, I think, try to be just one big mouth, but you know how that goes. And so there are all these different things that we're all made a part of. And God, Paul says, that's how the church is. Everybody plays a part, and they're all on the same level. They're all important. So there might be things that Coco can do that I can't do. But there are probably some things that I can do that Coco can't do. But we work together to do them, right? That's how God wants the church to be, and that's how He wants. So when you're playing with your friends or your brothers, your sisters, or your mom and dad, remember, God gave you special things that He didn't give other people. And He wants you to use them to help one another, okay? Well, I want to pray with you. There's no children's church, but the 3 and 4s are going, okay? So let's pray together. God, again, we thank You so much for these kids and the way they teach us. Lord, just pray You be with them and with us. Lord, as You help us to see how You call us to be the body of Christ. In Your name we pray. Amen. Well, thank you all.
continue to remind us to give and give generously so your work can continue to make this a wonderful church. Continue to bless each and every one of us and ask you all these things in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you. I invite you to continue reading with us in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. I gave Nikki the bulk of it this morning. Sorry about that, Nikki. We're going to finish reading through verse 31, picking up with verse 27 there. This morning we're beginning a series of sermons with the title, The Question, Am I a Church Member? As some of you may recall, over this past spring, we did a small book by Tom Rainer called I Am a Church Member. See how clever I was? I flipped that around and made it a question. Am I a church member? And so we're going to be discussing some of the thoughts that I've been sort of thinking about in that book. It was a suggestion by several people. They said, I really think you ought to talk about some of this stuff from the pulpit. So I felt like the Lord was kind of leading in that direction. So that's what we're going to do beginning today with the question, am I a church member? As we look in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, again, picking up where we left off in verse 27. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then deeds of power, then gifts of healing, forms of assistance, forms of leadership, various kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? But strive for the greater gifts, and I will show you a more excellent way. May God add His blessing to the reading and hearing of His Word. Would you pray with me? Holy God, now we pray that Your Spirit may speak to us through the words of Holy Scripture. Lord, may we hear Your words. May they go deep within us, into our very spirit. While my words, Lord, You move out of the way. Be with us now, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Well, let me ask you, what does it mean to be a church member? I suppose for some of you that's an easy question to answer. Being a church member means at some point in your life you made a decision to join the church. You either made a confession of faith and were baptized in a certain congregation. You moved your letter. Which, any of you have your letter? Got it with you? Anybody? No? No? I'm going to tell you a secret. We don't have it either. That's a phrase left over from a time when churches were expected to actually have letters of individual members because taxes were paid either to the church or through the church. So you might have moved your letter, or you may have joined by statement. That's another phrase we use sometimes, which means that you were once part of another church that has since either closed, moved, didn't keep good records, or doesn't like the church you joined, so they're not going to send you a letter. So you joined by statement. For some of us, being a church member means that you're here on Sunday mornings for worship pretty regular, at least enough to notice familiar patterns like when to stand and when to sit down and when to bow your head to pray, or some of the words to some of the songs we sing. Still, for others, being a church member is something like being a member of a social club, a fraternity, or a gym. They pay their dues. We call it tithes and offerings in churchy language, but they see it as membership fees. And in return, they get to use the church facilities for birthday parties, basketball practices, weddings, and reunions. Then there are those who see membership as a form of sort of sacred shareholding, as if their presence and money translates into power and influence. Those who see membership this way are the ones who worry themselves with counting nickels and noses. The ones who seem to know how often everybody else is at church and how much money they all give to the church. They see levels of church membership, and of course, they're at the very top level. Then there are those who see church membership as sort of a family business. Their family helped start the church, whether it was 2 years or 2 centuries ago. Their family makes up a plurality of the weekly attendance. Therefore, their family and usually one or two particular individuals in that family ought to be on every committee, board, and council in the church. And every decision needs to be passed either formally or informally by them before it's voted on by the church. That sound familiar to any of you? Any of those? I want to tell you something this morning. Something that you may not want to hear. Some of you may not want to hear. None of those things is what it means to be a church member. None of them. So if that's what you thought, go ahead, write on a piece of paper, ball it up, throw it in the trash, get rid of it. That's not what it means to be a church member. Membership isn't only about where your letter is, how often you attend services, or which services you choose to attend. It's not about paying your dues, belonging to the club, having enough money, or being a member of a certain family. Membership isn't about getting benefits from the church or having influence or power. Church membership, if it's anything, it's not about what you can get out of the church. Some of you don't want to hear that. I don't want to hear it. Now, lest we get too discouraged, these sort of misunderstandings about church membership aren't really anything new. In fact, it seems like since the church started, since the very beginning, that Christians have been struggling with these sorts of things. What does it mean to be a church member? We know that because of Paul's correspondence with the church at Corinth. Now, those of you who come to Tuesday Bible study over this past spring, we read 1 Corinthians together, and they're pretty messed up, aren't they? I mean, the Corinthian church has some problems. Arguably, many of them stemmed, what I believe, from a poor understanding of what it really did mean to be members of the body of Christ, the church. There were divisions in the church at Corinth. Paul starts out right away talking about them. Some of these divisions had to do with what some of us in pastoral ministry call preacher worship. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Some of the members claimed that they were disciples of Paul. Others, they liked the style of Apollos. He was the young, hip Greek guy that came in. Still others claimed to follow Peter, since after all, Peter was the rock on which Christ built the church. Then there were those sorts who, they liked to trump everybody by saying the sort of things that everybody already believes, but they say them anyway. You know the type. The ones who will say something everybody already knows, but they say it like they just discovered gravity or something. Well, you might follow Paul, you might follow Apollos, and you might follow Peter, but I follow Jesus. That's what they said. Can't you almost hear the arguments that happened in Corinth? Can't you almost hear where that division started? Somebody goes, well, I think maybe we need to have the Lord's Supper. Maybe we need to have the agape meal a little earlier in the day. Or maybe we need to have it a little bit later. And then someone says, well, I think we ought to keep it right where it is because, you know, that's the way we've always done it. Then another would chime in, well, you know, when Pastor Paul was here, we did it this way. But now here's Brother Apollos, and you know him, he likes to change things. Of course, the divisions at Corinth ran deeper than just playing favorites with pastors. One of the biggest issues at Corinth was the presence of those in the congregation who believed their social status and their wealth afforded them privileges that the other members of the congregation didn't have. They believed they were exempt from the struggles for righteousness, immune to the effects of even the pagan social mores of the time. In chapter 5, Paul speaks against one man who is sleeping with his stepmother. He says, even the Gentiles know that's wrong. A man who likely had power in the congregation and was therefore allowed to continue in his immorality. You know, that still happens. Some people come to church, they write a big check, make a show out of their presence. Then once they're outside the doors of the church, some of them don't even wait that long, they speak and behave in ways that reflect anything but the Spirit of God within them. These folks, however, are rarely called out because they're seen as critical members of a congregation. And if they're upset at all, if they're upset, they'll take their attendance and their money and they'll go somewhere else. Can I tell you something? Congregations have become paralyzed in recent years over the fear that if they seek to correct the immoral, sinful behavior of some of their own people, that they'll lose them. Because we've been fooled into thinking that the only thing that matters when it comes to church is how many people are there. Many congregations are more at ease, like the church at Corinth, with division than they are with discipline. And that was the case there. There were others there at Corinth who saw their power and their wealth as a source of privilege in the congregation at Corinth. Paul writes about the way the church would gather, would come together for worship. They didn't meet just once a week. They met every day and shared what was called the agape meal. And that was usually the big meal on the Lord's Day. It's the early church's take on communion. I really like the way we do it here, y'all. I mean, it's hard to beat those little squares and that cup. But the way they did it at Corinth, the way the early church did it, they came together and had a full-blown meal. Everybody. But at Corinth, the rich folks would come together early and start partying. They'd pass around the plates, the wine, just having a big old time. And then right after five, you know, when the whistle blows, everybody clocks out, when all the working folks would start getting off and show up for worship, there was hardly anything left. Just radishes in the salad bowl, rolls somebody left in the oven too long, and pots and pans scraped clean. Nothing. Even the good wine was gone. All those who got there early, the rich, the powerful, had eaten and drunk all the good stuff. And they were all in the living room, sitting on the couches, just having a good time. And all the poor folks who got there later had to go stand out on the porch. Now, there are Roman words for that. Some of them, the rich folks were in the triclinium, reclining on the couches, and the poor folks went out into the atrium on the porch and had to sit there. When the church gathered for worship around the Lord's table, they gathered, Paul says, for the wrong reasons. And people were left out. They were ignored or purposefully put outside because they weren't a part of the wealthy elite, because they weren't the right kind of people. And then there were those people at Corinth who believed that their role in the church, that was what made them more important than others. In the verses we've heard throughout worship today in chapter 12, Paul speaks to the congregation about the importance of spiritual gifts. And he stresses that there's a diversity of those gifts. See, there were some at Corinth who believed that their gifts were more important, more valuable than the gifts of others, particularly those gifts that involved being seen and noticed by others, in particular, the gift of speaking in various tongues. There were those in the congregation who believed that while God might gift everybody, there are some folks who God really gifts. You know, yeah, everybody's got gifts, but we got the real good ones, they thought. We're the exceptional people. They were the best church members because their gifts were evident and could be seen by everybody. So these people began to belittle the others whose gifts weren't so publicly evident. They began thinking that they were irreplaceable, that while the church could get along and do fine without some of those other people, it surely would die without them. And Paul writes to these folks. To this way of thinking, Paul points to the familiar metaphor of the human body. Paul uses it a couple of other times. The Roman and Greek poets used it. He explains that the body is made up of many members, many parts, and each part is especially made to perform its function within the body. Each part is unique and a part of the whole. And Paul says that's how the body of Christ is. Every person's role is important. No one is above anyone else. To a pinky toe, this is good news. But to a mouth, it means you're like a pinky toe. I mean, come on. To someone who's been told they have nothing to offer? To someone who's been told that they're not that important? To someone who's been told that they're not worth being here? To someone who quietly prays to God and says, God, I'm just wanting you to use me in whatever way you can in the life of the church. This is good news. It means that they are valued, that you are valued. Even if you think your gifts can't be used, even if you think you don't really do anything for the kingdom of God, you are valued by God. You are just as important as those who love to tell others how important they are. You are just as valuable as those who write the big checks, pray in eloquent language, sing with beautiful voices, and teach the Bible. We are all equally, beautifully part of the same body. But to someone who views church membership as a means to an end, who often asks, what can I get out of the church? the apostles' words grate on their nerves. They want to be seen as indispensable, as if their gifts, their time, their money matters more than that of others. That's why I'm learning more and more. Every time I go to this book, every time I spend time with God, every time I spend a little bit of time with Jesus, I'm learning that whenever we think it's about us, whenever our focus is on ourselves or anything else but God, then we read those words or we hear God speak and it grates on our nerves. No, that ain't right. It makes us uncomfortable. Paul's words to the church at Corinth and to the church at Williams are words that remind us that we are all indeed equally part of the wonderful work of the kingdom of God, and each one of us has a part to play. After all, faith, I don't know if you know this or not, it's not a spectator sport. And really, we've kind of set ourselves up to believe that because you are all sitting in seats and I'm standing on what some of us call a stage. We think it's a spectator sport. Really and truly, it's not. It's more than that. It isn't about having everything our way. It isn't about showing up, finding a good seat, and hoping to be entertained. It isn't about trying to be the head. We all say, yes, we're all part of the body of Christ, but I'm the head. And then we go, well, no, the scripture says Christ is the head. This is free, y'all. It's not in the notes. One of my favorite shows is King of the Hill. Anybody watch that show? It's not sinful. It's okay. I lived in Texas for 3 years. That show is real. That is how they live in Texas. Peggy Hill is King, is Hank's wife, and the pastor is talking to Peggy in an episode and says, well, you know, we're all part of the body of Christ, and Christ is the head. She goes, but I want to be the face. Some of us have that attitude. We're all part of the body of Christ, but yeah, he's the head, but I'm going to be the face. I'm going to be there. It isn't about trying to be the face. It's not trying to be the head. It's about resting in the joy and love of God that we are all called equally to be a part of this wonderful thing called the kingdom, this wonderful thing called the body of Christ. So I suppose the question really before us then is this: if we are all equally part of the body of Christ, called to use our gifts together for the kingdom, what part do I play? What part do you play? What can you do to be a better church member, a better follower of Christ? Now, I know the text our reading this morning ends with verse 31 of chapter 12. Paul says, strive for the greater gifts, and I will show you still a more excellent way. Doesn't that leave you wondering, though, what is he talking about? What more excellent way? What are you talking about, Paul? Don't leave us hanging. Paul didn't put the chapter and verse in there. We did that. Paul encourages the Corinthians, strive for the greater gifts that benefit the whole congregation, not just the things that make you look good. Strive for the things that benefit everyone, not just yourself. And then still he goes, and I'll show you. Or another way to say that is, yet I will still show you a more perfect way. What way? A way to be a better church member? A way to be a closer follower of Christ? A way to live more and more in the Spirit of God? What kind of way? And Paul says, yes. Because these are Paul's next words. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and angels, but do not have love, I'm a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I'm nothing. If I give away all my possessions, if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Y'all, it's everywhere. Do you notice that? It ain't just me. You know that, right? You read the Bible, and you can't run away from it. There it is. If I do not have love, I want to add something to Paul's list. Is that okay? Paul says something here about being a church member, and I thought maybe I ought to add something, just my own thoughts. If I attend every church service and meeting, but do not have love, I'm simply a seat filler waiting to be seen. If I give a lot of money to the church budget and designating offerings to the missions of my choosing, but do not have love, I'm simply a source of revenue which can be replaced by the one who owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. If I use my talents, my resources, my time for the church so that I might have my name spoken and my back patted, but I do not have love, I am not a church member. Friends, I am convinced that we all play a part in the kingdom of God. None of us is just here wasting time. None of us is just here twiddling our thumbs, waiting for the kingdom to show up. We all have a part to play. I'm convinced that all of us are equally important in those roles in the kingdom of God. None of us can say, well, other people are doing other things that are way more important than I'll ever do, so I'm just going to sit back and wait. We are all called equally. But friends, I am also convinced that if we are only in it for ourselves, only worried about our own preferences, desires, and tastes, we are not doing the will of God. So I want you to ask yourself, am I a church member? Do I strive to always be last, to put others ahead of me, to serve others and not my own need for power and recognition, not my own desires, not my own wants? Do I seek first to love God and each other? Am I a church member? Are you? Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we are thankful, Lord, for the many ways that you speak to us through Holy Scripture. Lord, grateful that when we think we've got it all figured out, Lord, that you remind us that no, we are not God, and you are. So Lord, help us. Help us, Lord, to serve one another, to work together in this great thing called the kingdom of God. Help us, Holy Spirit, to serve you with the gifts that you have given us, to recognize that they are just that, gifts, and not something we've come up with on our own, not something that we have earned by any sort of merit. But God, that you have gifted us. You've given us these gifts to serve you and each other. So Holy Spirit, be with us now as we ask ourselves, as we search our hearts, are we really church members? Not simply of this congregation, but the universal body of Christ. Are we really followers seeking to do the will of God? Be with us now, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. As you go out from this place, may you go with the God who calls you into the work of the kingdom, and may you be found faithful and willing to serve alongside him and one another. Let's pray together as we're dismissed. Lord God, go with us from this place as your body. Help us, Lord, to be your hands and feet in this world, serving one another, serving even the least of these. Give us the strength of your Holy Spirit, we pray in Christ's name. Amen.